So, hello all. This is Varsha Sharma, and I have Zeeshan with me. We both will be presenting you a topic which is ODO, that is a developer friendly command line tool. So, let me share my screen first. Let me know if it is visible. Yeah, is it visible, guys?
We can see it.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. So, me and Zeeshan, we both work at Red Hat. So we are based out of India. And I work as a technical engineer in middleware domain. And Zeeshan is an ODO developer. And he likes creating cool stuff with coding. So today we'll be presenting you a topic on ODO, that is a developer friendly command line tool. It actually makes developers' life easier who are not much more known about the Kubernetes and OpenShift container platform. It actually abstracts away the core concepts of Kubernetes and OpenShift and helps the developers to focus on what is important for them, that is the code. So how it improvises developers' life, you'll figure out this in this upcoming session. So basically, we'll be covering this whole talk in three topics. We'll discuss about ODO installation, its architecture, and we'll show you a short demo on how you can deploy a sample Node.js application using ODO. So ODO improvises developers' workflow. So how does it improvises the workflow? A typical workflow starts with creating code on your local system and ends with the containers running on OpenShift container or Kubernetes container platform, cluster platform, with code, your source code running on it. So you can visualize this workflow in terms of inner and outer loop. So in the inner loop, developers are the primary audience here. It can run on your local laptop. So over here, all sort of development activities, which is under developer's control, goes on, like editing, debugging, compiling, building up the code, etc. All sort of activities. And the outer loop, it comprises of a larger team. It actually consists of all those steps which a code has to go through while it's way onto the cluster, like integration tests, compilants, and compiling, building, deploying to staging. And several of these steps are often automated using CI/CD system. So in the inner loop, when a developer reaches a degree of satisfaction that, yes, a feature of a degree is achieved, so the code is transitioned from the inner to the outer loop. So for that, several of steps are carried out in order to transition the code from inner to the outer loop. So there are a lot of steps, like how you have to configure the OS for the container, then packaging the application for the container image, creating the container image, and then pushing the container image to the repository. So these are a lot of steps, and thereafter deploying the application and then deploying the services on which the applications depends on. So some of these steps are automated by ODO. So let's discuss about it. So ODO is basically a command line tool which is written in a very simple language, that is Go programming language. It provides fast automated source code deployments, which helps developers to focus on the application source code rather than worrying about how the application gets deployed onto the OpenShift or Kubernetes cluster. And it has got easy iterative development cycles. And it is entirely on local client, so no additional server is required. And it can basically run from any terminal, Mac, Windows, and Linux. So you can simply get the binaries, download the binaries like from here, and run it on Linux, Mac, or Windows, whichever is the suitable platform from you. Then who is ODO for? So ODO is basically a tool for developers to focus on their source code, like I said, who are not familiar with the OpenShift and Kubernetes concepts, who doesn't have deep understanding of OpenShift and Kubernetes, and don't want to create complex YAML resource files, and they just want to know how their code works just from the starting till the end on the cluster, OpenShift cluster, Kubernetes cluster, and the OpenShift platform. So several other clients are command line tools are there, like OC and kubectl, which are more operation focused. So you don't have to worry about that, how OC or kubectl works. You just can easily deploy your application using simple audio commands. So it minimizes the use of OC and kubectl. It doesn't replaces them, but yeah, it minimizes the use of them. So what audio does, like I said, there are a lot of steps while the code, source code is transitioned from the inner to the outer loop. So it automates the build configuration, deployment configuration, service routes, and other OpenShift elements which are required while transitioning the code. And it is designed for quick iteration. Like, for example, it will deploy the changes onto the cluster, and it will also give the developers the feedback at the real time in order to make some changes. So audio is provided in these IDEs like VS Code, OpenShift Connector for IntelliJ, then CodeWind for EllipseG, and it supports Node.js and Java components. And this, with the new release, which is recently introduced day before today, that's 24th September, Audio V2.0. With that, NPM, Spring Boot, and Quarkus is also supported. So I'll give you a pictorial representation of how you can deploy an application onto the OpenShift cluster or the Kubernetes cluster. So in Audio, applications are the basic, like you can say, application name is my app, the default name, and you can use the virtual concept of grouping the components together. So components are the things which the application is made of. So the next, you can just simply create an application by using Odoo create Node.js. Node.js is, with Odoo create, you specify the language in which the application is written in, and with --, app flag, you can just pass the application name. So if you're familiar with the Git flow, Odoo follows the same flow like Git. Like in Git, we do Git init to initialize that where our local code is running, in our where our source code is running in the local directory. And the editing after the source code locally after Odoo create is similar to doing Git commit. So Odoo basically follows the flow same as Git. So after creating a simple sample component like Node.js, you just simply need to create new storage by specifying the path and the size for that particular component, and it can be attached to that component. Likewise, you can list the available components in the audio using catalog list command. It will list out the components available. And in order to create a service for your component, you can simply use service create command to create a database, like for example, and link that database to the backend component which you have created. Then after creating the database and linking it to the backend component, you can create a front-end component for this backend component. It's an example, just a pictorial representation of a simple configuration that you can do on Audoo. Then after creating it, you can simply link both the front-end and the back-end components using a simple Audoo link command. Then you can create a URL through which your application will be accessed. So in Audoo, everything is in context. So context is something where your code is going to, code is present. So default is the current working directory on your local system. So this was a simple configuration, a one-time configuration which you did, which you can do using Audoo. So after doing this configuration can be just pushed onto the repository. And after doing all these configuration, you just simply need to do Audoo push. So what Audoo push does, it will automate the creation of deployment config. And it will create index files. It will create other OpenShift elements which are required, like PVCs, services, route. It will create everything. And it will push the source code onto the container. It will copy your local code onto the container under temp's source directory. And after the code is copied, it will restart the application service without killing or rebuilding the application. So this gives us hot reload. So even if you want to alter the code, your local source code after doing Audoo push, you can just simply change the source code and you can simply do Audoo push again in order to reflect the changes. So this was a brief overview of what you can do with Audoo. So in simpler terms, Audoo is like an elder magic wand for the developers on working on OpenShift and Kubernetes platform, those who are not aware of the deep understanding of the understanding terminologies of Kubernetes and OpenShift. So enough of the overview. After this, you are going to see a demo where we'll show you how you can deploy a sample Node.js application using Odoo. So I'll hand it over to Zeeshan from here. Zeeshan, it's all yours now.
That was a good overview of what Odoo does. So let's see if I can start sharing now. Let me know if you can see
from my end.
Yeah. So I hope everyone can see the screen share.
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. So like Varsha said, we are going to be doing a little small demo. Like, we're not going to do something complicated this time, but we have time, shortage of time. And also, we're going to be using the latest version of Odoo, which is Odoo V2 that got released yesterday. So this is the app we're going to be deploying. This is a simple Node.js to-do app. And this is what it looks like. It uses etcd at the back to store this information. So let's go ahead and try to deploy this app. So I already have the code here cloned already. So I'm going to, the first command is obviously I need to create the application. But before that, I can do Odoo catalog list components. So this basically collects information about what kind of components are actually available in a cluster and shows them. Like, for example, there are def file components and there are normal S2I based components which are available on my cluster. So we are going to go with def file components because that's going to be the default going forward. And the way this works is through registries. So there's actually a command to add your own registries and stuff. We're not going to get into that in this demo, but just for information. So for now, we are going to deploy a little Node.js app right here. So I would say Odoo create Node.js, and let's say I give it an example name. So it's Odoo create kind of component and then the name. Let's go with the default name. Okay, so what just happened was it created a file in your repository. So this is basically a local configuration. It explains what your local development environment should look like. Generally, you will not have to touch this. So Odoo is already working on adding commands to able to manipulate everything. I mean, at least all the main stuff, like URLs and all the URL already is there, but there are other stuff that you can manipulate, which the commands are incoming for that in the future versions. But for now, you can even manipulate this dev file if you really want to. But it, in most cases, that should not be required. So this actually explains that this is a Node.js component and how do you run the component and stuff like that. And this is committable, like you can commit into your Git repository and anyone else can just do another push in the future and they will get the same environment. And there's also a env.yaml, which is not to be pushed into the Git repository. This is to contain information specific to your environment that you might have created. So let's go ahead and push this component. So the first time, of course, the containers, the deployment config needs to happen. So it can take a little bit more time, but once the flow starts and once the first push has done, you will see a drop in the amount of time that the application needs to deploy. So you can see that there was a URL defined in that comment component and stuff. So all of that stuff is always being created for you. And if I see OC get points, you can see that there's a Node.js thing that's running there. So it's deployed. So let's go to this URL. This is interesting. Just give me a sec. This sometimes happens to my browser, so sorry about that. Interesting. Okay, this might actually be a problem with the cluster. Let's just give me a second. So I had another cluster, a backup cluster. So let me just switch to that instead. I guess the demo calls are not with us today. Just give me a second. Actually, let's just call this URL. Yeah, you can see that the content is there. There's something wrong with the browser. Maybe. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to a go for a different app instead. This is something that again I prepared for. So let's go ahead and try a different app, a simpler one. This one is not going to be that crazy app. This is a very simple different one. So Odoo create Node.js So the problem here is that there's something that I faced before where the cluster itself was acting up. So instead of that, instead of doing a little bit more complicated application, we're just going to do a simple one instead. So here goes nothing. Okay. So there's also a command called Odoo URL list, which you can see if any URLs were created or where they were created. Yeah, so you can see that there is a reply from that application. Okay, so it works. Now, let's say in a typical development environment, what will I do? I'll go to the app and I will change something. Let's say I go to my server.js, and instead of saying this, I will say blah. I'll add something to this and I will then do an Odoo push. You can see that the amount of time that it took for the first time and the next time is reduced. So if I go back to my app and if I refresh this, I should be able to see the change. Yeah, so you can see that whatever I made a change is published. So another thing that you can do is actually create services. So go to catalog services list. It's a command that actually gets the information about services from, sorry, it is the other way around. It gives a list of all the services that are present in the cluster. And that can include operator-based services or template based services. So old OpenShift or had something called templates, service templates. So you can use those if you have those. But for this, we are going to use operators. So this is an operator that that a couple of operators that do exist on my cluster. So a fair warning right now is that the operator backed services were added recently, as in beta. So it is not completely like awesome, but the basic functionality is there. So how would I create a service, right? So I'll say Odoo service create, and then I will give the name and the any one of these depending on my requirement, and it should create a service for me. So a service has been created. So if I do Odoo service list, so you can see that there is a etcd cluster example service. So I'll just copy this name, and then like you can link components to each other. You can also link services to each other. And then I do an Odoo push. This time, the reason why it took a little longer again was because this is a config change. I'm adding a service and I'm linking it. And it's up. So in the other example, I could have actually shown you the etcd being used, but since we skipped that, what I can definitely show you is that if I get the pods, and this is my example pod, for example, my app pod, for example, and then I'm going to do an OC exec hyphen IP of this pod. And if I do a print env, and if I grep etcd, you'll see an environment variable called etcd cluster underscore cluster IP that my app can now use to connect to the etcd cluster. So these environment variables are basically most of the time based on practices, like even the operator, the person who created the operator can specify what he wants the EMVs to look like to be exposed to the service. So this is for the etcd, it is just predefined that most people use etcd cluster underscore cluster IP as their environment variable. So that's what it uses. So you can obviously, if your app can consume this, if your app uses it, and do whatever it wants to do with that. And then there is also a really cool command that was added called Odoo watch. So let's say I did Odoo watch. So what this does is you just run it in a terminal separately, and then you can go ahead and start editing your file. So let's say I edit my server.js and I add something else to it. I save it. It's already been pushed. You don't have to worry. It's going to run separately in its own terminal. And that's what a tool like VS Code or something would do. They would just run this in a terminal and forget. So that you edit, you save, it's done, it's pushed. So this is actually a slightly known bug where it sometimes pushes twice, but it finally gets your stuff out. Yeah, so if I refresh this, okay, it's something to do with demo gods, I guess. We don't have time to sit and debug this. So yeah, I guess that's it. So let's go continue with our presentation then, I guess. Varsha, can you continue the presentation? Yeah, I don't have it open right now.
I'll share it. Is it visible, Zisha?
Yeah, I think it is.
So yeah, like I said, that it automates several of the processes when we transition the code from the inner to the outer loop. So what basically the architecture is, while the deployment config is built, basically there are containers created, like init containers, then the application runtime containers, and the component configuration. So all these configurations are automated, like you saw in the demo, that while we do the audio push, it does all those things in the background. So by default, it uses the dev file as the deployment mechanism for deploying audio on OpenShift or the Kubernetes cluster in this recent V2 release. And previously there was S2I available. And if you want to deploy using the S2I deployment method, you just need to specify --S2I, and the code will be deployed using the S2I image. So you can find the dev file file contents at this link, which I have mentioned over here. I guess my slide changed. Yeah, over here. Let me show you. Over here, you will find the complete architecture for the S2I image, which was previously available compared to this version. And for the audio dev file repository, this is the official site for audio.dev, where you can find all of the basic understandings about audio, like regarding installing and how you can deploy a single component application, multi-component application, and all. Like the example, the pictorial representation which I showed you, it was a multi-component which you can deploy using audio. Next, there is a supervisor daemon process which gets started as soon as we do audio push. So it is the first PID which gets started. So as soon as we do audio push, after creating deployment config and all those OpenShift elements which are required, it will start the assemble and restart script, which is in control of supervisor D process. So what will happen? The code will get synced with the supervisor D restart, assemble and restart scripts, and the service will restart. So the supervisor D, along with some scripts, there are several scripts available that CLI needs to execute on the application container, which are provided by the init container. So as soon as we do audio push, the init container starts, and it acts as a vector and does all of the processes in the background. So we don't have to worry about how that particular application is going to get hosted on the OpenShift or the Kubernetes cluster. We just need to do audio push, and it will take care of all these processes in the background. So like this, it makes developers' life easier who are not familiar with OpenShift and Kubernetes concepts. So with the latest upgrade which we have, that is the dev file, which is released yesterday. It is v2.0, the official site which I just showed you, that is odio.dev. Over here, the default mechanism to deploy is the dev file. And these dev, what are these dev files? These are basically the resource YAML files with a defined schema. And you can find more details about this over here. These are the registry dev files. So you can contribute and help us make improve this project better. You can just go to the site and explore it more in order to know more about Odio. So yeah, this was it from our side. If you have any questions, please share with us.
Okay, thank you, Vavasha and Mohammed. Great talks. So if anybody have any questions, just type in the chat panel so that we can feed this question to them. Just to begin with, I do have several questions. The first one is that what's the difference between Odo and the kubectl?
Okay, so kubectl is a very, very Kubernetes specific CLI, which is basically means that it interacts directly with the Kubernetes resources. Like you need to give it a deployment config, kubectl create FNF a deployment config. And the deployment config needs to be written by you, right? So that is what kubectl is. It's more admin focused. It's more, you directly interact with the Kubernetes resources. Here, the thing is you don't see those Kubernetes resources at all. This is hidden in the background. You give a deployer, you give that dev file or whatever config file that to us, which is either you download it by doing the create or you give your own dev file in your application. And that is converted into the respective Kubernetes resources automatically. So at the end, you will get a deployment config. If you say OC get DC, you will see deployment configs there. You will see pods there. You will see routes there or ingresses there, but you will never see it through the Odo CLI.
Okay. Thanks for the answering. And I have another question. Is that I noticed that you are installing Node.js, right? So we know that for Node.js, it can automatically sync with the changes you have on the code, right? But for Odo, do we need, is that possible to automatically, I mean, for the web page, it syncs with the changes, or you have to rebuild to push again?
Okay, so at this point, you will have to do an Odo push for the sync, like because the code is synced to a Node.js setting inside a container. It's not a Node.js on your local laptop, right? It's a Node.js sitting inside a container. So you need to definitely get the code there. And the only way to get the code there is to do a sync, which is to do another push. But after that, we just tell Node to do what it does. And this is actually there. Like for example, Java is a thing, right? So Java also has a hot reload, right? So there, if you use a Java container, it actually doesn't do a build at all. So similar kind of thing. If the container supports it, we do, because we just push it to the container and run the respective commands. What happens on the container is the container's responsibility.
Thank you. On the first question, some audience mentioned that one main advantage on Odo is that user doesn't need to know too much about the Kubernetes when developing their applications. Odo handles the Kubernetes resources for you. It's more like the Odo is in the upstream of the Kubernetes control, right? So that they can in high level. So okay, for more advanced user, they can still take the dev file to have a fine-grained control on those. Odo can also handle the application build logic for the user, which is captured in the dev as well. So that it looks like Odo can have a broad, I mean, can also have a fine-grained tweaks on the files. I mean, regardless of the, it's more like in the upstream of the Kubernetes. Okay, thanks for the explanations. Any other questions? Yeah. So let's wait for a couple of minutes. I don't know if or not. So people still have any other questions. By the way, do you know the reason the applications fails? Is that belongs to the cluster or the application itself? The reason when you try to deploy?
Oh, that's a cluster problem because I've had this before. I've tried this app twice before doing this, two or three times actually. The first time it worked fine. Second time it failed. I redeployed the cluster and it worked after that. So there's something going on with the cluster. Because if there's a problem with it's not a problem with the application because it works. I know for the fact that it works because it has worked twice for me. So it was something weird that happened in the cluster for some random reason, which can happen because it has happened when I ran through this once or three times before.
Okay. Thank you. If no more questions, so we think for this talk, we're gonna end here. And thanks again for the Varsha and Mohammed for the great talks about the OpenShift 2 developer demonstrations. So it's very fascinating. So everybody deserves to give a try after the talks. And so the next meeting, I think, is gonna happen at 11:30. So the speaker is Amit. So he's gonna talk about Cogito Cloud Native Business Automations. I'll go also type in the type channel so that the audience can see it. Yeah. If that's all the question for the first talk, we're gonna stop here. So just wait for 10 more minutes for another talk to get started. Okay. Thank you, Varsha, and thank you, Mohammed. I have to remove you guys from the video sharing because I want to restart the recording. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Anne.
Yeah. Bye.